about crossing over the Red Sea. The crossing of the Red Sea will be our theme today. It's Exodus chapter 14, verse 10. Before I explain this verse, you probably know the story about Moses. And he led the Jewish people out of bondage in Egypt. And he led them for more than 40 years. And they came to the Red Sea and they had to cross it. And you know, during that time of his travel, he was given the Ten Commandments. And there's lots of incredible events that happened at this time. So first, let's open in prayer. Father, thank you for this morning. That we know that you are so awesome and powerful, and you are in control of all things. We do not need to be worried about anything. You take care of all of our needs. We only need to have faith in you, Lord. You are awesome. We pray that the people will search their hearts. You know their needs for their lives. And that you are involved in everything we do. You are so incredible, and that you give us mercy and love and grace. Let your Holy Spirit open our hearts. And know that you are helping us with our struggles and challenges we face in life. But we know that sometimes people forget about God. But just like we'll be studying about today, the Israelite people had forgotten about you, God, and your awesomeness and your power. But we have to keep remembering that, God, you are highly exalted. You give us your wisdom as we read your word. You are truly powerful, because your word is powerful. And we thank you for that. And we thank you for everything you do for us. Your love, your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now before I delve into verse 10, I'll give you a little preview. The Jewish people at that time had been crying out to God because they were suffering so much in Egypt, being in bondage. And the taskmasters in Egypt were very oppressive of them. You know, at that time they were building the pyramids, huge pyramids of Egypt. And that was the Israelite people that were building those, and that's what this story is about. Now, 400 years prior, Joseph became the governor underneath the Pharaoh, who was the king controlling Egypt. Joseph had a dream that for 7 years that the people needed to save their food. And then after the 7 years, they would have plenty for 7 years, and then after that it would become very dry in the land, and there wouldn't be any food. So Joseph had told his dream to the king. The king believed him. Now after Joseph had passed away, Now, Joseph was like the fourth in the generational line of Abraham. Anyway, at this time, the Israelite people, Jewish people, were suffering and crying out to God. Today they realize what skills that they have in building the pyramids. They were perfectly made. And they couldn't understand how in the world the Egyptian people had the knowledge to have these built so perfectly at that time by the Israelite people. And even today, people are still amazed at the perfection of those pyramids. Now, to go back to our story, the king finally let the Israelite people leave, and Moses led them out of Egypt. Now, remember, there's 3 million Jewish people. You know, when all these 10 plagues were occurring, with the water changing to blood and the frogs and everything, all of that that befell them in Egypt, the Egyptians, was miracles from God. So when the Israelite people finally were able to leave, they thought they had hit a place where they could go no further. There was the Red Sea there before them. And they thought, well, this is it. And they were trying to figure out, what were they going to do? Now, let's look at verse 10. And it says, and then Pharaoh through 9, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. when the Israelite people looked around and saw the Egyptian soldiers coming after them, a large group, they thought, oh, the Egyptians are just going to abuse us more and kill us. They're so angry at us. And you know, when the king lost his firstborn son, he was very angry. He changed his mind. And he wanted to kill the Israelite people. And he wanted to bring them back into bondage again. So the Israelite people were naturally afraid when they saw the Egyptians coming after them and crying out to God. And when they turned around and looked and saw the Egyptians marching out, and they panic. You know, we see that in this world today also with all the wars and things that are happening. People get afraid. And you know, they're concerned about not having enough money and they've got all these worries. So we see this still in society today. Now let's look at verse 11. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, has thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore, thou hast dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt. The people of Israel, they had panicked when they realized their oppressors were coming after them, and they thought, we're going to die. So they had, their thinking process had become extremely negative. They thought, we have no work, we have no food. And you know, we hear that a lot. We hear people constantly complaining and now in a panic state and concerned about the affairs and what's going on. And this is what's written in the story. And they thought, well, we're leaving Egypt to start a new life. And now all of a sudden they're in this panic-stricken mode because they realize the Egyptians are coming after them and their talk had become very negative. And you know, people of this world that are not saved yet, they really are in bondage to Satan until they accept the Lord and are saved. And that's when they're able to let go of the things of this world and turn to God and become a child of God and have that relationship with Him. You know, when you're in the way of the world, you're depressed and Satan's got control of your life, and it's just like you're in bondage. And then when you turn to God, you have a new life. But I'm here to tell you, Satan will still come back because you made him angry when you become a child of God and you are saved. And Satan's going to come back and he's going to try to tempt you again and again into the ways of the world. You know, we see sin everywhere we look in this world. We're supposed to walk in peace and joy that Satan does come back into your life. But all of us must be strong and face this world and resist the temptation Satan with the word of God and also through prayer. That is how Satan hates it when you pray. And he will flee. Now, mind you, he will come back again, but you have to continue to go to the Lord and pray. You are no longer in bondage. You are saved. You are a child of God. And the Israelite people in this story, they got all in a panic and they didn't know what to do. So let's look at verse 12 here. It says, is this not the word that we spoke to you in Egypt, saying, leave us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. Can you believe that they were in such a state there? The Israelite people were saying, I prefer to go back to Egypt. I will serve the Egyptians than die here out in the wilderness. Can you imagine that? We see that same type of thing today. People are looking for the comfortable life. If you come to church, you read the Bible, you pray, God will attack you and you'll have frustration. And they think, gosh, I should go back to the ways of the world and live a comfortable life. And that's what we're seeing here. They're crying, they cried out to God to be set free. And now, when they're faced with challenges, they want to go back. Where's their faith? What happened to their faith? Why have they entered in such doubt? People, when faced with challenges, they have doubt and they think their life was better before. They forget about that it's better to go to church, to read your Bible. They think it'd be better to go back than that they stay crying, neutral, low. I am telling you now, we must persevere. We must fight our way through this. We belong to God. We can face Satan. We can resist the vials of this world. As we're reading in Scripture, we are a part of the army of God. We see all this throughout history of all the events that happen. I want to help you see the blessings of God. Never quit on God. You know, a lot of people, they just quit. They stop having a relationship with Him. And it happens to hearing people and deaf people as well. For example, maybe they owe a lot of money to the government and they feel like they're stuck. You know, they have a lot of bills and they don't know what to do, so they go bankrupt. Instead of facing their problems, they're fleeing from their problems. Even some people go as far as to go to a different country to flee what they owe the IRS. But you know what? Problems will always follow you forever. They're in your mind, your worries, your concern. If you murder somebody and you go and you hide, you have such guilt every day of your life. Even if you still verse 13. We're working out a little bit of technical issues here. Right here, verse 13 says, "And Moses said unto the people, and I like this part here, "and see the salvation of the Lord." Notice it here upon the wall. See the salvation of the Lord. And the people are looking around like, what is he talking about? They thought it was the end of the road. There was no place to go. They were stuck there at the Red Sea. And what happened, you will never forget what God did. We need to just watch the Lord, see the salvation of the Lord. Now let us continue. And it said, "He will show to you today for the Egyptians whom you have seen today. You will see them again, no more forever." And Moses said that to the people, that after today, you will never see them again in your lifetime. Interesting here, and he said, "He will show to you today, to the Egyptians whom you have seen today, you will see no more again." He clearly told them, "You will see the Egyptians no more after today, for the rest of their lives. You will never see them again. Will be dead." What Moses was trying to tell them. He was trying to tell them not to worry. Let's look at verse 14. I really like this verse here. If we could adjust the slideshow a little bit so we can see the scripture. Not to running back to mom. face our challenges, persevere through them. Isn't that powerful? You know, We lost that game. We shouldn't be blaming people. We shouldn't blame the referees. We need to go forth. Don't dwell on this negative stuff. You need to forget it and move forth with your life. All people make mistakes. You know, people get divorced and they shouldn't dwell on the past. They need to get over it and move forth. They shouldn't look back and think about their divorce and everything that happened. If they were used to be on drugs or any addiction, they need to get over it, not dwell on that. Get over it and go forth with their life. Don't worry about the past. It's finished. Amen. People dwelling on their lives and things that have messed up and mistakes they've made, or maybe they feel embarrassed about something happened. Get over it. Forget about it. Forgive others. Forgive yourself. Just forget. Forget the past. Go forth. Start your life now forward. We must face our challenges. God will take care of us. We must persevere. Don't give up on your life. Follow God 100%. Because as for me, behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And I will be honored through Pharaoh and all his armies through his chariots and his horsemen. Now verse 18. I like verse 18. It says, and the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. It says, and the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. Now, mind you, the people were all in a panic. And it clearly says here that the Egyptian people will know that the Israelites are God's. You know, there was miracles that was happening back then. We see the same thing today. People still deny God. God does miracles. And we see people that they don't listen to God. You know, there's some atheists out there that just ignore him and don't believe in Jesus Christ. And there was the final one. verse 21 again, it talks about Moses stretching his hand out over the sea, and it was divided by the strong wind. And it occurred all night long and turned the sea into dry land. The Red Sea literally divided, so there was dry land in the middle. Can you imagine that? That's real. It's not a fantasy. Somebody didn't dream this story Step Church here. How in the world did it happen? It was God. He did it. He divided everything through the Word of God and trusting in Him. He created this church. It is so exciting. You know, some people would look at us and they had negative attitudes and they judged me and criticized. And that's fine. And they were suspicious about things that were going on. But I stood on the Word of God like Moses did. I had to faith. And I had to believe that God would take care of us and that the people would follow. Hold on to that. says, and the Lord swept the sea back by the strong east wind. That's in verse 21. And I'll show it to you up here. You know the wind that's talking about here? That caused the land to become dry. That was God's power flowing down, drying out the land. So the Israelites' people could pass through. And after they had passed through the Red Sea, the Egyptians
came.
You know, God is just like a fan. He turned off the fan, or we'll say he turned off the wind. And then the ground became like mud again. So when the Egyptians tried to cross over in their chariots, they got stuck in the mud. And let's go back to scripture, to verse 25.
Come forward.
true stories in the Bible are never boring. You explain everything. When the people enter into worries, concerns, and doubt, and want to turn back, Moses calmed the people and said, "Stand still and see the Lord save you. You will never see the Egyptians again." It's the same thing that we see today. That's because